worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 92. Going for the 100, the first 100, recorded on the 16th February 2018. There are three questions, one lotus offering, and first the normal intro. Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha. As you see here, it's fairly misty outside, so we are inside today. Drizzle and nasty. Before we start, I'd like to remember to click subscribe and the small bell and like for all good purposes, so you help these videos being shared around the world and also get notified everyone time there's a new video. Secondly, there's old Buddha Direct Group passing link here and linked in the description of the audios and videos. Click subscribe there. If you're not already subscribed, then you will have these regular Buddhist emails coming from whatbuddhasaid.net. On whatbuddhasaid.net is also advertised two meditation courses. I have arranged two 12-day meditation courses going through all the orthodox 40 meditation objects given by the Buddha, emphasizing on six of them, going through Buddhist history, Buddhist canonical texts, and ethics, and a lot of other topics. A lot of meditation, both walking and sitting, and I can highly recommend it. There's one in June here in Kandy, nearby here. You see the meditation center's pictures here. Very nice place, very suitable place. And then there is one in December 2018 in North Carolina, USA, also a 12-day course. And you can find the details and how to apply on whatbuddhasaid.net front page. There are the two meditation courses, June 2018 and December 2018 is advertised. Then to the lotus offering, which is done for Sumrit Singh Yoha, which come from India but live in United States, in New Jersey, close to New York. And he likes to dedicate the offering to my awakening, enlightenment, and the enlightenment of himself and those who are near him, and all other beings, plus his educational and economical welfare. And the lotus offering comes right here.
Hello to you, friends. This is a small lotus offering again of a magnificent bunch of mainly white but also blue and red lotuses and malpich flowers and incense sticks. And this offering is from Mr. Sumrit Singh Yoha, which is of Indian origin but living in New Jersey, USA, New York, close to New York. And he dedicates the merit of this flower offering for the liberation of me, very kind of him, his parents and family, his spiritual mentors, and to his own economic welfare and career and liberation. So we say thank you to him while we zoom out of the lotus under the Bodhi tree here, that we will go and offer in Lord Buddha's tooth, in a tooth temple, right over there. Thank you.
next Buddha. So Buddha will say, yeah.
So much for offering lotus. Now we go to a completely other, unfortunately quite sad but repetitive subject, that is a recent school shooting in the United States. Again, completely unnecessary shooting down of 19 students in a high school in Florida. And I just like to remind that the first Buddhist precept is I accept the training rule of no killing, of not taking any life, of not stopping any breath. Panatipata viramani sikapatang samadhiyami. And this is really crucial. This is the first thing one has to learn. In United States is, as I think is fairly well known, a lot of guns. Here you see the gap, the map over guns per capita. And there's 100, currently, according to Wikipedia, 101 guns per 100 people. That's little more than one gun per capita, per human being in the United States. And also a fair amount in Europe, but you see Asia is almost free of it. And of course, these guns are completely unnecessary. And research done in USA where these school shootings and mass shootings are very, very common. Very, very common. Without the American people, the American politics, nor the American presidents being able to do anything seriously about it. And that's very sad because people are gunned down unnecessarily. And of course, this extreme number of guns per people. Here is Sri Lanka is two gun per people, two gun per 100 people. In Denmark is 5 guns per 100 people. In USA is 101 gun per 100 people. So the cause for these school shootings and mass shootings is obviously this extreme amount of guns, which is advocated to protect, but research shows clearly that they are used in the house against the inhabitants themselves. Father killing mother or children killing each other or whoever. They should be used for protection, that's the argument, but they often become used for the exact opposite in family arguments and other kind of arguments that otherwise would not have ended in violent death, simply because there would not, there is no gun to shoot. But if there is a gun to shoot, and if there's mental problems and conflicts, then these guns is used. So again, a first reminder of Buddhist ethics, how it starts with simply saying, okay, I want to abstain from killing anything that breathes, or life, taking any life whatsoever, the rest of my life. I won't take it, because other beings' life are as important to them as my life is to me. So how can I take what is dear to me from them? That's hypocrisy. So one has, it starts there, it's very, very fundamental. It has to be so that beings deliberately and voluntarily, by their own understanding, sees, this is crazy. This is a road downward. It's a catastrophe for any society to have 101 guns per 100 people, because then they are the risk, the probability, just by chance of them being used against human beings and other beings, are extraordinarily high. As this tragedy, this repeating, recurring, ever recurring tragedy clearly shows. Then we go to the questions. The question 273 goes like this. Buddhism talks a lot about mind. Yet the doctors talk about the brain. Are these the same? Please relate this conundrum to the unconscious situation. Very, very interesting problem. Mind-brain problem, or mind-body problem, or philosophy of mind, as they call it in classical philosophy. Before we start, I just like to say that before I start to say something about myself, that is actually one of the 10 deliberately undeclared and unresolvable issues put down by the Buddha, which is as follows. What is the 10 indeterminable and unresolvable issues that was deliberately undeclared by the Buddha? 1. The cosmos is eternal. 2. The cosmos is not eternal. 3. The cosmos is finite. 4. The cosmos is infinite. 5. The mind and body are the same, inseparable. Thereby, the mind and the brain are the same, they are inseparable. Or 6. The mind is one thing and the body, brain, is another thing, that they are separable. And that's exactly these two, 5 and 6, is about these two questions. After death, a Tathagata exists. 8. After death, a Tathagata does not exist. 9. After death, a Tathagata both exist and does not exist. 10. After death, a Tathagata neither exists nor does he not exist. These 10 questions are undeclared by the Buddha because they are, even in principle, not resolvable. They cannot be answered completely, absolutely. So this means that you can put forth various views, and to the extent that these views are contrary to other beings' views, then you end up in a conflict situation, which have been described like this. And they lived arguing, quarreling, and disputing, wounding one another with weapons of the mouth, saying the Dhamma is like this, not like that. The Dhamma is not like that, it's like this. Udana from 6.4. The first thing is from the Undeclared Sutta, which is from the Anguttara Nikaya Book of 7, and it's Sutta 51. Due to this irresolvable nature of these 10 questions, then they should be laid aside. Should be laid aside, since they provoke endless and fruitless speculation and dispute, which, needless to say, blocks any progress whatsoever towards the ending of suffering. So the Buddha deliberately did not declare anything about this, whether mind and body are the same or different, whether basically brain is a part of the body, huh? Whether the brain is separable or not separable from the mind. However, I like to say something about how it looks to me right now, knowing in advance that this will not be the last thing said about this issue, and also knowing very well that the Buddha has said that these questions, even in principle, are irresolvable. So we should just know this is an open-ended thing. One can put forth various views, but one will never be able to resolve the issue on the absolute basis. I started as a doctor, and then I would say the mind is a function of the brain. Basically, electrical currents, small blips that all have the same spikes. It's a small spike of 30 plus 30 millivolts, all looking the same between different neurons in different wires called axons. And since there is these 100 billion neurons, and there's a lot of firing that can be measured collectively with the EEG, then this electrical activity somehow make up consciousness and mind. However, there is, and this is a good working hypothesis, because if you anesthetize people or they get a heart arrest, then you get a flat EEG, and then also mind seems to be not there, because it doesn't manifest itself in any sensation, nor, as far as we can see from outside, nor does there come anything out of mind, any speech or any activity of the body. so far so good. So if you intoxicate the brain or you give it a mechanical knock and so on, then conscious functions are impaired. Brain surgery also. And there's some specificity to it, but still it's not full specificity. So this means that the injury here can produce some memory lapses, but then the memory comes back spontaneously to where this area is. So apparently the memory didn't only sit in one particular area. Because, for example, people that has been operated in a particular area cannot remember what time it is. They look at the clock, but they don't recognize what time it is after the surgery. However, then 1 to 3 months after, without relearning the time, nobody learns them about the time, then suddenly they can interpret the time when they look at the clock. Then they know what the time is. So this means that information is not local. It's not sitting in a small part of the cells here, the watch here, and your childhood there, and so on. It's not like that. Then one say, the information is distributed over the entire surface of the brain. But I think one has to go actually outside the brain to find where the information really is. And this I say mainly because of near-death experiences. And near-death experiences has repeatedly been proven that people can tell about things that happened in their surroundings or elsewhere accurately while they were brain dead. That means that they had no heart function and a flat EEG. No electrical activity in the brain. The EEG is flat 15 seconds on average after the heart stops. There's no blood pressure, then 15 seconds after, the EEG is completely flat. Then the brain has stopped functioning. If this goes on at normal temperature for more than 6 minutes, then the brain is basically dead or severely damaged. And then the person will come up in a vegetable state, might be able to survive on a respirator, but cannot move and will never be conscious again. However, there are certain cases where they do live up. A recent case was a heart surgeon that I'll give the link to the video up here in the corner that told the following story. And he's not religious at all, and he doesn't believe in reincarnation, but he has experienced this for himself. He was specializing in putting in new heart valves. Had a private hospital, small private hospital, together with a partner, and they only put in new heart valves. A very common problem, people having usually a bad tooth, and then the bacteria go to the heart valves, take up the heart valves, and you have to put in a new heart valve. Technical, difficult surgery. Then, because you have to take out the, you have to put people on a heart-lung machine that put in oxygen in the blood and pump it back into the patient and take over the heart's function while you open the heart and put in the heart valve, close the heart again, and then you should take them off the machine so the heart should start to pump itself, and then gradually you wean them up the machine. Usually it can take something like half an hour, and so they have a blood pressure of their own. But this patient in particular, he talked about, they could not get off the machine. The surgery was successful, no bleeding, the heart valve was functioning. The heart was beating slightly, but it didn't pump. And they worked for 6 hours with all various kinds of treatments. All there is in the book, all there is on the shelf of tools and medicines and techniques to get the heart to pump again so they could turn down the heart machine and get the patient out of the operation theater. But they could not. They could not. They could not get a blood pressure, a working blood pressure. So eventually they decide, well, we cannot get the patient off the machine and we have to declare him dead because he has no heart function. Was electrical activity in the brain, but no pumping. So at that time, the surgery has taken 18 hours. So at that time, the surgeon left together with his assistant, a younger heart surgeon, and they went and dressed their clothes and start to go out into wash and come back in their green surgery clothes. Which is kind of like a t-shirt, green t-shirts. And they stand like this in the doorway to the open, now open, not sterile, operation theater. A very large place, actually, often. And then something like 100 square meter, in that order, 60 to 100 square meter. And the anesthesiologist that was in, sitting in front of the heart lung machine, he was left to take juice. He's been sitting there for 18 hours. So he was left to take some juice and get some food. Then while they were discussing this, standing with the arms across like this in the doorway, then all the catheters, the patient were lying open, with chest open. Everybody just left the theater before packing down the patient. So all the monitors here under, a monitor that is put into the artery to measure the arterial pressure. This could be seen on screens all over the theater. And then they, while they were discussing this, and the surgeon reported that they were standing there approximately 15 to 20 minutes discussing this. What could they have done something else? What could have been done? What was the cause that the patient could not pump, and so on? Then he started to pump. Bloop. There come small blips of arterial pressure in on the screens, on the monitors. And then he yelled out, "Ah, come back, come back, come back," to the anesthesiologist, and the anesthesiologist come back. They start to give him medicine, fluids, blood, so on. Eventually, they got 20 in blood pressure, 40, 60, and then eventually they could take him out, stitch him up again, and then take him to the intensive care unit where he became conscious after 2 days. And then the interesting thing, what baffled and floored this hardened cardiac surgeon, and I recommend again to see the video for yourself, to see him witnessing this, was that when he asked the patient and interviewed the patient, first of all, the patient had no brain damage. He was completely coherent and had memory of his past life in USA, and could remember his family and so on, and was reasonable to talk with. So he had no apparent brain damage. This was first of all, that's why he was talking with him. He also told the various universal characteristics of a near-death experience, which is going to another place where there's light, music, meeting dead relatives, coming to some transition zone where they have to come back, and so on. But he also told of something that could be corroborated, confirmed, and that is that he have seen the surgeon and his assistant stand like this. And he said, you stood like this in the doorway discussing why I died and what we could do about it. And this baffled the heart surgeon. Then there was another detail that is, in my opinion, the proof of the pudding. When a surgeon like that, he has tons of telephone calls all the time. Then he has given his mobile phone to a lady on the floor, a nurse on the floor. And she had the job to take note, and she will take the note on some small yellow note blocks, usually size stickers, and then write the telephone number and then put it one place on a plate, whiteboard inside the operating theater. And then he had instructed her, because he got something like 20 to 30 calls doing a surgery of this length, that she put them like this. The next one she'll put on the first one. And the third one she'll put on, the fourth one she'll put on the next one, and so on. So there was a whole row, a whole chain of small notes with telephone numbers. And then immediately after the surgery, he'll take a sandwich and a cup of juice or coffee. Then he'll go out, start working the phone. And then he could do this by just taking the whole chain, chuck, off the blackboard or the whiteboard, and then go out and then take one note after each other and make the phone calls. This set that was on this whiteboard in this operating theater, and it wasn't there when he came in there, there was a chain of telephone numbers, and the patient told that the nurse keep coming in with small yellow notes and sticking them to each other in a long chain. This is proof of the pudding that he had perception, visual perception, lying there, behind a green curtain, usually the patient cannot see in front of this because there's a green curtain in front of the anesthesia, between the wound and the anesthesia, which has access to the tube and can see the color of the patient's face. Secondly, they tape, in order not to dry out the cornea of the eyes, they tape both eyelids so you cannot see anything through the eyes. Still, this patient had visual perception from an above the body position to tell about this specific event that a nurse keep coming back putting notes on the blackboard, yellow small notes. And you know, how could the patient know that? He went out there unconscious, intubation, doing intubation, rolled out with a respirator to the ICU. When he came there, the notes were not there. Nobody had told him about this very specific habit. Usually it's not the case that you get that many. She'll not write it on a note block, one or two numbers out there. But because these surgeries are fairly long, in this case 18 hours, then she written it down in this way, by his instruction. And this is one of many other near-death experiences where the patients doing a situation where they have no blood pressure and thereby no EEG, flat EEG, thereby no brain function. Still, they have perception about specific things going on in the operating theater or doing resuscitation that can be confirmed independently after they wake up. And there you have to say, now we're in a situation where we have a patient that is brain dead because there's no blood pressure, there's no heart function, there's no EEG after 15 seconds. And we're minutes into this situation. How could they have visual perception? How could they tell about this? How could they tell this being unconscious with taped eyelids lying behind a green curtain? There's triple doors there closed to their visual perception of this specificity, of these details, technical details. So there, obviously, mind is not dependent upon brain. And the same thing with mind going from one brain to another brain, to another body. They are also doing transmigration, doing the Patisandhi, rebirth transmigration moment. There also, mind has to be not dependent upon any brain. So I think it's like this, basically, that quantum mechanics tells us that all quanta of energy, and thereby also the quanta of energy that is represented by consciousness carrying information, that is also an equivalent of energy, they have these two very contrary or complementary characteristics. One being particle-like, local. This is this brain that perceives now from a special perspective. And the other one being wave-like or field-like, everywhere present at the same time, basically non-local. And this non-local mind, non-ego mind, no me, not I mind, is what is seeing these perceptions during near-death experiences and travels from one body or from one form to another form in doing transmigration, have these verifiable out-of-body experiences, inducible out-of-body experiences doing various kinds of drugs. Here under LSD, psilocybin, psychedelic mushrooms, and so on. So I think that there is there's data that talks for both that mind and brain is the same, and there's also something, these near-death experiences and other things that talk for that in certain situations, mind and body can be separated and then unified again. If we should say about, well, what is the function if we look about the local aspects of mind and brain now? then I think there is one of the analogy that is particularly apt, and that's apt, that's an analogy of mind being a computer. So a computer have a CPU and a memory and so on. So and then it has a lot of software, and then it has a database of information. So I think the brain is like to computer, and the mind can be likened to the software that can be copied and transferred from one brain to another brain, and to a third brain. So, like the software can be copied from one computer to transfer to another computer. Where is the data? The data is non-local, it is everywhere present in the entire universe. So the data is in the cloud. The memory is in the cloud. So perceiving and remembering is cloud computing. You're sampling data from outside now via YouTube, huh? That's actually also coming from the cloud, a computer cloud. But I think your memories, both of this particular Dhamma on air number 92, which you will remember word for word on your enlightenment day, probably in 576 million years, this where it will be present for you word for word, while tomorrow you cannot remember hardly anything of it. And even after 5 minutes, you cannot remember 80% of it, what has been said here. But even though so, why is that you can remember it in 576 million years word for word? This is because the information is not stored in the brain, because you have a tons of brains before that time, new brains, huh? In new lives, both human lives and animal lives and deva lives, I hope, and many deva lives as possible. And they obviously have another body and another brain. But still these memories of past lives will be present and can also be present now. And this is an indicium of that it's more like a transmitter. It's a receiver of information and an emitter of information. So consciousness emits information that is stored externally everywhere present as waves of probability and past memories, past events, basically all past events, also physical events like a raindrop falling, is stored everywhere with a probability of one. And this means that one can see all past events, basically. What comes to mind is one time Sariputta, he said that now his awareness, his sati, was so present, was so acute, that he could enumerate all raindrops that has fallen on planet Earth since the beginning of planet Earth until now. Again, he could enumerate 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 billion, blah, 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 200,464, enumerate all raindrops that has fallen on planet Earth since the beginning of planet Earth until now. You know, this is something, it's a very unusual thing to say. And we know he was an arahant, and he was an akasavaka, one of the two prime hit disciples of the Buddha. He was a general of the Dhamma. So it should not be taken lightly or taken as superstition or self-overestimation that he, a considerable time after his enlightenment, states that now his sati, his mindfulness of past events, remembering, as you know, there's two articles in awareness, awareness of the presence and remembering what happened long time ago. And this second article of what happened long time ago was in his awareness, his sati, his mindfulness, so acute, so expansive, and so accurate that he could enumerate, again, enumerate all raindrops, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on, that has fallen on planet Earth the last 13.7 billion years in which planet Earth has existed. So this information, of course, is not in the brain of these physical, non-mental events of raindrops falling. They are out there and out there, and so are your memories. So the memories are in the cloud, everywhere present. The database are in the cloud, everywhere present. The software is something that can be separated from the computer, the brain, and replicated in another, copied to another computer. But the computer obviously is important, crucial, and it will have manifestation if you crush or damage the computer on what comes out of it, out of the computer, what's displayed on the screen, basically, and what calculations it makes if you damage it. Like also, if you damage the brain, then the people's speech will be different and their remembrance will be different. But this is not a proof or indication that the memory is stored by the brain, nor that the mind, the software, is ultimately speaking dependent upon the brain, because they can be transferred, just like the software can be transferred from one PC to another PC, then the mind can be transferred from one brain to another brain, or from one kind of matter to another kind of matter. That's the local aspects of consciousness that jumps. But we remember all states, all quanta of energy, all phenomena has these two complementary aspects, the particle-like local aspect at the same time as the non-local, wave-like, field-like, everywhere present-like aspect. So you cannot say because one thing at place, one thing is a special place at a certain time that it's not at the same time also is everywhere. Example, gravity. Gravity now is here, huh? If I drop something, then it falls down. But at the same time, it's everywhere in the universe. There's gravity. Same with space. There's space here. Same, there's space everywhere. Light coming from the lamp. This here, but it's also everywhere. The electromagnetic radiation, which is also a field, basically of light that is outside the visible spectrum, is also everywhere present. Otherwise, your mobile phone wouldn't work. Huh? And the information that the mobile phone is transmitting is also in the cloud. Just like much information now on the internet is in the cloud and not stored on a local hard drive somewhere. Or is stored on many local hard drives, distributed out. But when I say in the cloud regarding memories, then it means that the memories are basically everywhere present. And that's why Buddha can read it. If he had to tune into the right frequency, then he can read other people's former life and see what they did and didn't do 204 lives ago. And what was the cause at that time, two effects happening now. That's one of the 10 powers only Buddha said, Dasabala, the 10 powers. So again, one, it's in principle a resolvable question whether the mind is synonymous, is the same as the brain, or is it different from the brain. Two, things point in both directions. Some aspects are says that they are very much dependent upon each other, just like the computer is dependent upon the software, and the software is dependent upon the hardware in the computer. But some other phenomena, near-death experiences, transmigration, out-of-body experiences that are confirmable and has been described numerous times now for the last 20 years, points to that mind in certain special situations are not dependent upon the brain and can probably in one moment jump from one form to another form. But just is basically, one aspect of it is basically it's non-local, it's everywhere present. So it is already there where it's jumping to. It's just this local aspect that unfolds in a new egg somewhere on the planet here, either an insect egg or in a human womb, in a human egg or in a animal egg, or is spontaneously a reborn at the deva levels. So again, think about the computer. The memories are in the cloud. The software is transferable. The hardware is like the brain. Is in one particular computer. One particular computer. I hope this answers this question. Then we go to question 274. How did you become interested in Dhamma and your history as a bhikkhu? Yes, I become interested in the Dhamma because I long been it actually. One, because my father has sailed in the East and then he has noted that Buddhist waiters, they had waiters on the ships at that time. They always made his bed completely perfect. And he always spoke very positively about Buddhism. He's not, was not a Buddhist that time, and neither is he now. But he was sympathizing with Buddhists because of their discipline and because of their tendency to make things perfect, basically. And then later on, I became interested in it because I became disappointed about the world. I started thinking that white-robed people, that is scientists and doctors that go around either in lab coats or in doctoral coats that are both white, they were kind of like holy people that didn't go to the toilet, nor did they have sex, nor were they affected by sex, drugs and rock and roll. And then I became a doctor myself. Then I several times saw that people got academic positions and large research grants and employment as medical doctors because they were sexually attractive to those who employed them. It's usually senior researchers or professors or senior doctors. And so this whole sex, drugs and rock and roll scheme, and I saw people cheating because of money and cheating with research, lying and so on. So suddenly I saw from inside with my own eyes that these white-robed medical community and a community of scientists, they were by no means mentally pure. By no means. No means. It was quite the opposite, actually. Well, the tricks were more, the dirty tricks were more concealed. They were better hidden. But basically it was the same dirty tricks as everywhere else, as you can see in the schoolyard and in the kindergarten, fighting about the toys, fighting about the positions, fighting about name and fame and money and so on, and accepting sexual favors and then employing somebody who were not qualified to do this job just because they were willing to deliver sex to the senior doctor or to the senior professor. So this disappointed me so much, and also I saw the issues of being involved in research and patenting and not publicizing, and this whole economical mud between private sector and public sector research, and this huge greed and craving for money and fame. This suddenly became very acutely present for me, and then I saw people behave according to the defilement of the mind. And I suddenly realized that these teams, because you work in teams, both as doctors and scientists, the performance of these teams were not something that has to do with their qualifications as professionals. It has something to do with the purity or impurity of their mind, whether they could agree or disagree to do the right thing. And usually they could not agree to do the right thing. They could agree to do only something like 50% and downwards of what was the ideal. And that, I think, was extremely, extremely disappointing. And seeing that these people acting like children, basically, being grown up, being senior and having a white coat, they acted just like as primitives, as spoiled children did, actually. In some cases, even like animals did, or worse than animals. And it's disappointed me. So I start to turn, I become very moody blue about it. And then one day I saw that there was a Tibetan Lama in my area, close to Copenhagen, that wandered around and planted trees in the local area, voluntarily. And so, this is the right guy, I go and talk with him. And then he taught me to not to be angry with the world and do universal friendliness meditation. And then my moody blue feeling, my depression, is evaporated in a short time. And then after having met the text, the Tipitaka text, I immediately recognized, ah, this is the real deal here, the Tipitaka text, the canonical text, probably because I've seen it numerous times before. Then I changed direction to Theravada Buddhism, the teaching of the elders, the original, authentic teaching. And this I stayed with ever since. And that's it's the best decision I ever made. Usually very people come here up here in the mountain and interview me, and then several of them have asked, have you ever regretted that you took this decision to leave your academic life in Denmark, where you could live in comfort with a wife and a son who is now 23? And my answer is also no. I'm not considered even 1 millisecond. Not 1 millisecond. It's the best decision I ever taken, is to become a Buddhist monk. And it's been the happiest 16 years of my life so far. It'll probably be even better. I hope so. I hope so. So this is basically my story. Then it did come before I decided to ordain. It took some 4 or 5 years as a lay Buddhist. And before I actually ordained, it took 3 years more. So it was something that came very gradually. I approached the Dhamma. As I read more and more, studied more and more, and start to meditate more and more, then suddenly it became evident to me that the mental purity talked about systematically in the text. And then what I met on my workplace of children playing toys with other human beings' life. This was so disparate that it became absurd to participate and have responsibility for what these teams did. In some cases, approximately one a week on a major hospital in Copenhagen, I would see a patient die that possibly could have been saved. But because her doctors were in a social and mental state that didn't promote professional doctoring, then they were lost. And this was unbearable for me to be a member of such a team, because I could not change the therapy. It was has to be there's a collegium of doctors who decides what's the therapy of a given patient at a given time point is. So I think, I cannot be even partially responsible for that at all, that dirt. So I'm very, very happy I left that. Very, very happy. I'll never go back to it. Never, 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 never. It will be terrible, terrible, terrible. How long did you start in Sri Lanka, or did you begin in Denmark? Yes, I began in Denmark. I was a Buddhist 5 to 7 years before I came here to Sri Lanka. Actually, I planned to go to Thailand to ordain, but then a Danish monk say, come down here. Then I came down here in 2001, and then ordained next year, 2002. So this means I've been a monk for 14 years and 6 months. And since I had a little more than a year as a novice, as a Samahita, a small recluse, then I've been ordained in the robes for 16 years and 1 month right now. So there you got it. I hope this answered the questions. I can highly recommend it, at the right time to go forth. Not too early, not too late, but to go forth. Because then one has a chance on the long run. It's like an extremely good investment. If one is ready for it, then it's, I think, the ideal investment in the future. Where the usual case is that people come to death and then there will be downfall, then for those who have ordained or those who have taken the precept and kept them pure, then there will be ascendance to either a higher level at the human level or even to a divine level. So you can say whatever your pension scheme says or your economy says, it doesn't determine what happens at the moment of death, whether it'll be this way or that way. But what you do up to this in your senior life, the last 20 years of your life, irrespective of what foolishness you have already done while young and while being adult, not Buddhist, then the ideal case is either to become a very serious lay Buddhist, which can also make significant progress on the path and certainly even transcendence to the divine state at the moment of death. But ultimately speaking, ordaining would be the best if one is mature enough to do it and have the health to it. I have approximately, or I'm in contact with or reach out to approximately 100,000 people now 3 times a week. And there are many who speak about it and kind of like are toying with a thought. And this I also did. I'll just say, come on, friends. Come on. Don't be afraid. You will be as happy can be. Come on. The Sangha welcomes you. Question 275. What is the best method to overcome knee, hip, and back pain during meditation? Should a meditator make a mental note just that, or should a meditator mindfully move? Yeah, first there's the preventive side. One has to have a proper posture. What is a proper posture while doing sitting meditation? Yeah, that is to have a straight back and crossed leg. Not necessarily lotus position, but just crossed legs. There's many parts of crossed legs, but just sitting down and then crossing legs, usually with one's seat above the floor in the order of 2 hands breadth minimum, can also be a little higher. This will take the pressure off, especially the knee and the hips. There's now a tons of meditation benches. I'll show off them here. Can be bought on Amazon and various places, both portable and non-portable, and pillows. Meditation pillows, because people, many people have started to see. And I will give the advice, invest in this, try the ones that find you, and then know that finding the correct posture and the correct number of pillows and the correct thing to do while meditating is not so easy. Usually it's something that develops slowly over the years. So it's finding the exact right posture is something that takes time. So give it time, but work on it and keep preventing. As soon as you have the right posture, then many of these problems, not all of them, but many of them, I would say 80 to 90% of them, they will fall away, will not come. Know that you can stretch the legs out from the cross leg position at any time, or also, if that is necessary, raise up and stand and then move the legs a little bit before sitting down again. That's perfectly legal. So otherwise, keeping a straight back, and that is best done with putting one's thumb here in the ankle between the mandible, the lower jawbone that goes up to the ear here, and then from to the tip, there's an ankle point right there. Putting one's thumb there and another one there, and then make what we call a cosmic traction upwards. Then one comes up. Now once you can see that now my back is straight, huh? So you not sit with the tip high or with the chin high. One should sit with the nose pointing completely horizontally forward. But as soon as you start falling down like here, then bad posture, then the knee comes in, the back pain comes, huh? So always remember, this cosmic traction, and smile. You cosmic traction. Then you have a right posture. This one is too stiff. This one is too far. Then the trick is to focus attention regularly on the chin. Because usually what happens is the chin starts falling down. And then the posture starts to degrade as you become more and more relaxed. And then the head starts falling down. And then sometimes the body starts slowly moving forward until one sits like this with the head forward hanging in the back sleeping. This happened for me several times, that I find myself sleeping, sitting up, but with the head hanging something in between the legs, sitting up cross-legged while sleeping. Sleeping is, of course, has nothing to do with meditation. So before changing the posture, it is good. There's two tricks one can do. As author of this question is this, one should just mentally note it. But one trick in particular is very good is to, if one does Anapanasati meditation or whatever meditation object one has, then refocus on this object. And this is because mind cannot have two objects in mind. There's only one door open to attention at any given time point. This means while you are feeling pain in the knee, then you are away from your meditation object. And if you drag mind back to the meditation object, the breath touching the nostrils, or the universal friendliness beaming out from the heart, then you cannot feel the knee if you do it 100%. And this you can, all minor pains, I would say, can be overcome without moving, without changing posture, by this intensifying the focus on the meditation object, whatever it may be. Whether it be the tactile breath touch in the nostrils doing Anapanasati breathing meditation or any kind of other object. Then the sensation is can be felt, but it's kind of like a very alien, remote, dampened echo feeling of this pain that doesn't bother you really. You can't say it's there. It is there. It is still there. Or sometimes it fizzles out. It goes away completely because of this redirecting mind back to the meditation object forcefully and really intensifying. There one use actually this pain to intensify one's awareness of the meditation object. And that's a very skillful way of using the pain. So it can be used, turned from an disadvantage to an advantage. Physical pain during meditation, whether in the knee or in the back or in the stomach or wherever it may occur. This goes for any discomfort during meditation. Can be used to intensify the focus because, as I said, mind cannot have two objects in mind at the same time. So if you're on your object, meditation object, then pain goes away. And as soon as you focus on the pain, then your meditation object goes away. So the ideal thing first is, of course, prevention. Ideal meditation posture, prevention by the right pillow, the right meditation bench, sitting in the right place, the right meditation posture, straight back, chin high. Remember this chin high always, huh? As soon as the first sign of the posture degrading is chin starting to fall down. So chin high, and then cosmic traction. This is the ideal prevention. Together with the right bench, the right pillows, placed in the right way. Ideally, the body should be like a parked car, locked car, the turn off motor. Doesn't do anything, just stand in there. So you park the body someplace and then you go meditating another place, in another world. Then the body should not bother you and call you back from wherever, whatever state you have attained. So it should be like a parked car, ideally. But as soon as the body have pain, then it starts screaming, come back, come back, come back. And then you start redirecting your attention away from the meditation object to the knee or the back or whatever. If the prevention doesn't work and you're redirecting attention to your meditation object doesn't work either, and you wait sufficiently long time trying to refocus or let it fade away by itself, then one should mindfully note pain in the knee pain, deciding to move, intention to move, and then move the leg forward or find whatever new posture, intermediate posture, that gives relief, and then go back to the meditation posture as soon as this relief has been established for a short time, let's say some minutes. So first prevention, right pillows, right posture, cosmic traction, chin high, straight back. Then refocus and see if it fades away by simply putting mind firmly on the track of the meditation object, because then it cannot pay attention to the pain. And thirdly, if necessary, after having waited and tried the other two techniques first, then one can mindfully, in full awareness, labeling it twice every step of from deciding to do it, deciding, wanting, willing, intention to move, move, turn, sit, or stand. And then go backwards again when one returns to one's posture. This is the ideal case. But again, I'll give much more detail and we'll try it in practice, both regarding sitting meditation and walking meditation. Doing these two meditation courses, I again give the links to, and you can go to whatbuddhasaid.net, and then there will be two links providing each a program and how to apply. And this is in USA in December 2018 is more than 60 available seats, and in this in Kandy here in Sri Lanka, not far from where I live, is around 15 seats left. Here in Kandy we will also we have the advantage of being close to relics of the Buddha, and we will visit two places, the tooth relic in Kandy and the hair relic and a collarbone relic in Mahayangana, doing two bus trips, one at the first day and one at the last day. And that one will have this nice and rare opportunity to offer a lotus to the Lord Buddha's relics, and then ask, just like we did here in the intro, then dedicate, and I recommend that the participants do that, dedicate the merit that they have, will attain absorption and have a successful meditation course during these 12 days in June and 12 days in December. Thank you for your advantageous attention, your clever consideration and kind contribution. Thank you to all the Dayakas, all the supporters, all the donors, in particular and especially those who give a small amount every month to make the wheel running here on the Hermitage and the videos keep producing. Those who give food also every month, which is needed every month. You can find out to go to whatbuddhasaid.net and then see the link to food giving and regular giving, and also to those who support the meditation hall, which we built right outside here, and which everybody is welcome to come and visit, both before it is finished and after it is fully finished. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha indeed. And not the least, may you have a nice and noble day.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya, will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.